Right. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming. Welcome. First and foremost, so hello, my name is Kaylee. I'm reverent into the father, my grandfather's Blackstreet Wood people, and I'm from the city, Arizona. So I'm from the reservation, and part of the reason I'm so excited to hear this tonight is because a lot of us, my family included, a lot of us in our community were unaware entirely about this. So this is hopefully something I can bring back and something we can share, and a lot of members from our community are listening in. So yeah, thank you to the presenters. Thank you for Hall No. Thank you to me for putting this all together. Oh, is this working?
I'm sure the switch is still up. Is the switch still up?
Still up. Not working. We just wanted to open with a prayer really quick. So if you want to remove caps or bow your heads, whatever works best for you. Oh my gosh. Okay. Kudo hujodomer vastan shema yarete shita hayoska nohodev ish nohatsui cha. Did not the endosis now genits or did the whole sleep the best sad if not the free auto all the in shiche hashed as the in shiche hashed a whole one of the son shema auto nasan and lay shema the jonagon nas go nit nit nanik at the bed the jonagon pretty team with hot one nas nick hot dollar nihit so this in do nihigin not the end dollar. DJ Bahi Kagin is going to go down. So on a big apple, Hojana Hasli, Hojana Hasli, Hojana Hasli, Hojana Hasli. Hopefully, I can get this right.
Let me see
it out.
Let me see real quick.
Yeah, despite it being on, it keeps cutting off.
Is it the switch or just something else?
It's the switch.
Yeah, just be careful with it, it seems. Yeah. We'll figure it out. I think that we have a mic issue, Leona, so if there's a problem, we will try to speak loudly, okay? Hopefully you can hear us.
Okay, well, we got 32 people or 31 people online. So I hope the mic works for everyone, and thank you everyone for your patience. We're all here. So thank you for being here. And so excited to get started.
Okay, so first
turn it off and on if it cuts off.
First up, we're going to start with Leona Morgan of Hall No. We could give her a little warm round of applause.
Yay, thank you. So I'm just going to chat for a little bit. We're recording this. I'm not really sure when it'll be posted, but I want to just introduce myself quickly. And it's so nice to see everyone's faces and names on the screen. Hall No hasn't had a Hall No event in some time. So this is an amazing turnout for another, you know, kickoff of Hall No's work. And so I know there's another event going on nationally, so we're competing a little bit, and I'm really excited to see everybody here. Anyways, she'e, like I said, my clans are Kodich-Itni, and I tend to be a grandma. Right now, I'm in Albuquerque, and I am in graduate school. I do a lot of work in New Mexico, focusing on kind of New Mexico issues. But tonight is all about Hall No. Klee and Serena and I, we started Hall No really at the end of 2016. So I'm just gonna give a little background. and then I'm going to welcome others to chime in when you're introducing yourself to just fill in the gaps of anything I leave out. So for Hall No specifically, I'm not going to really get into the mine yet. I think we're all here because we care about our communities and all of you who are here, I think are all here because you're concerned about the uranium, the possibility of uranium mining at the Grand Canyon and the transport through our communities, which we want to stop. And so we'll talk a lot about the issue and go over the specifics. I'm going to pull up the hall route here in a couple minutes, but I just have a couple minutes to give a background, and all of the information I'm sharing is available on our website, hallno.com. And so back in 2016, we just got started because as Diné people, we wanted to support the fight to stop uranium mining at the mine, and then also to support the fight at the mill. So both of these are Indigenous fights with the Havasupai challenging what was then Canyon Mine, now Pinyon Plain, and then the Ute Mountain Ute folks in Southeast Utah still fighting the mill today. And so for us, the concern was both the mine and the mill and the possibility of new uranium mining when our nation, our colonial government, the Navajo Nation, has a law against new mining. And we also have a law against transport. So the thing about it is our law, subjecting to a colonial system and the government structures that be, well, we don't have jurisdiction on the haul route. And we don't have jurisdiction in a lot of places where future mining may happen. So even at the Grand Canyon, and then of course, I always want to talk about Church Rock and things in New Mexico. But going back to the mill, just to talk about the mill for a second, this is the only operating mill in the country. And it's a big deal right now what's happening locally, because we're seeing the impacts from what's happening nationally and internationally. So the fact that the United States is still pushing for new nuclear, despite a lot of work on fossil fuels and climate, people still think nuclear is an answer to climate change, which it is not. We can talk about that later. But also, there were just two international meetings. In New York City was the TPNW, a UN meeting about the treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons. Basically, they're going to keep making more weapons. The United States is putting a lot of money into new development. And then in Dubai, the convening of parties just completed, and of course there is a big push for new nuclear. So what we're feeling at home on top of that is these, what do they call them? Sanctions to not buy anything from Russia. So now, we were buying a lot of our uranium from Russia. So now there's this push for new uranium mining, and we see the price of uranium just going up and up and up. In the meantime, Hall No has been very consistent. Even though you haven't seen us around, that doesn't mean we're not watching the mine. The mine hasn't really been moving a whole lot. But since 2016, when we started, Klee has been very diligent about doing the monitoring, getting footage, and then all of us working together with some of the speakers here today, we had a lot of help. We'll tell the story of what happened. In 2017, we went through a lot of communities, starting at the mill. Hall No did presentations in at White Mesa, Blanding, and then coming into Arizona and going all the way to Flagstaff and then to Red Butte. We tried to tell as many people as we could, even our name says it all. And so we're still here. And even though this thing that happened recently that we're going to talk about, this national monument, it was really to protect the Grand Canyon from new mining. However, there's a big thing that got left out, which are these valid existing rights. And we're going to talk about that tonight. So I'm just giving a little background. Navajo Nation has a law against new mining, transport. We did a lot of education in over the years. Right now, the Havasupai and some of the fight on the legal side, we're going to talk about that tonight. But we're really at the point where we're asking folks to take action. And so I'm going to stop talking now. That's a very broad overview. So essentially, if you read the flyer, where we're at tonight is the Pinyon Plain Canyon uranium mine is the closest it's ever been to starting. And Hall No has been watching them. And through our footage, through our observations, we know they're very close, but they haven't started yet. And so right now, we want to talk about what can we do to stop them? So that's what we're here to do tonight. And thank you, everyone, for coming. Welcome. And Klee, please fill in anything I left out when it's your turn. And
Leona, next up, we have Alicyn Gitlin of the Sierra Club. We can have a little round of applause.
Thank you. Right. My name is Alicyn Gitlin. I live here in Flagstaff, and I've been working with Sierra Club's Grand Canyon or Arizona chapter for the last 13 years. I am actually in my last month of employment with them. So if anybody wants a really rad job that is posted on the Sierra Club website right now, I would love to get a passionate person who really cares about this issue to take the reins after me. At Sierra Club has been since the 1980s fighting this mine in support of the Havasupai tribe and everybody else who has been opposing it. And it's really been very heartbreaking to see it get so close to development in the last few months. I personally have been trying to track the science
Just try to keep it as still as you can. Just switch it on and off, and it should work.
I think it might need a new battery. It's not staying on. I'm gonna talk really loudly. Is this the library's microphone or?
No, it's on the computer.
Oh, is it? Okay. Can those online hear me?
Thumbs up.
Okay, I'm going to talk really loudly. So we've been, as I said, we've been fighting this mine as an organization for decades. In the last few months, it's been really hard to watch what's going on. There has been a lot of science, not enough science and monitoring going on, but there has been some science looking at the mine site and looking at the water supplies. Right. Are you okay if I just take this off while I'm talking?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Looking at the mine site and looking at the risks from this mine to water, soil, and air. And so I've been trying to track the science pretty closely. And it's really frustrating to see there's more unknown in this region than there is in most of Arizona. We have very, very few monitoring wells in the region. So we don't really know how water moves through and around the mine, but we do know that the water supply in the area of the Pinyon Plain mine, formerly Canyon Mine, is hydrologically similar to, connected to the deep aquifer that is below the mine. So there's two main aquifers in the region. And sorry, I'm going to get a little wonky. So hopefully you can all follow me. There's two main aquifers. One is several hundred feet down, and one is about 2,000 feet down. And in drilling the mine to the depth of a little over 1,400 feet below the surface where it is now.
Hello.
Okay. In drilling the mine to a little below 1,400 feet,
the mine encountered that sea aquifer and started taking on water. And so about 8 to 10 million gallons of water has been pumped out of the mine every year for the last several years. This mine is very high in arsenic and uranium and some other contaminants. And it's being put into, is being put into a pond where it is being sprayed into the air to evaporate it. Wildlife is accessing this pond and the deep Redwall Moab Aquifer, which supplies all of our largest springs in the Grand Canyon region, including Havasupai, including Garden Spring and others, is at risk because of this. There is one monitoring well in the Redwall Moab Aquifer. It is thought to be up gradient of where the mine is. And so there really is no monitoring. We will not know if there is deep water contamination until it emerges at a spring. And by then it will be too late. So this mine is putting the water at a huge risk. It's also putting the soil and the wildlife at a huge risk. At the Pinyon Plain mine already, arsenic and copper within the mine fence are at a level that has been determined by the EPA to be toxic to plants. Uranium and vegetation around the mine is at 3 times the background range. Radium in soils is already elevated. And so for those who collect plants around the mine site, this is obviously a huge concern. And for wildlife that is accessing the mine, the water, and the plants, they don't know that they're putting themselves at risk. Reclaimed mines in the Grand Canyon region actually have shown soil contamination at levels higher than operating mines or mines that are in the act of reclamation. So we do not know how to contain this dust. We do not know how to clean it up. And then that brings us to hauling of uranium ore. And so the ore trucks are going to move through. There's two routes they could take. That can either go through Flagstaff and Williams, and then up through Cameron, Tuba City, Kayenta, and then up through Ute Mountain Ute land to the mill. Or they can go through another dirt road through Forest Service land that'll take them out near, if you know where SP Crater is, Hank's Trading Post, it will come out near there. The environmental impact statement for the mine was written in 1986. And at that time, they said that if they took the second route, they would only go by one residence because they did not consider homes on the Navajo Nation to be residences. They only considered one ranch house to be a residence, and which in my mind is extremely racist. The problem with both of these routes is that the trucks are going to be covered by a tarp. We don't know if that's enough to contain the uranium dust. And the problem, the real difficulty with uranium ore is once it gets inside your body through dust or through water ingesting the dust, once your skin can't block out any of the effects, it becomes way, way more dangerous. And so these trucks being on the road are going to put everybody at risk. And then if there is a spill, they're going to put everybody at greater risk. And I know we're going to talk about the haul route more later, so I can continue on that after. But I see this as just a disaster in so many ways. And it's just been really, really difficult to see it happen. So I thank you all for being here, and I will pass it on to Taylor.
You guys hear that?
It wasn't me.
All right. My name is Taylor McKinnon, and I'm the Southwest Director at the Center for Biological Diversity. And we do what our name says. We try to protect biological diversity. We try to prevent extinction. And so we do a lot of federal litigation, lawsuits, and campaigning, primarily focused around endangered species. This matter deals with or intersects with endangered species in that the water in the aquifers around the Grand Canyon discharges into springs that have remarkable biodiversity. Some of them have species found nowhere else on Earth where this water comes out. And so it's incredibly precious water, and it's precious water from an evolutionary standpoint, in addition to its importance to the Havasupai tribe, all the regional tribes. The list of those values goes on and on. I want to talk about a few things. One, I want to pan out a little bit and talk about the abject failure of the federal industrial uranium complex.
Yeah.
And I think it's important for us to pan out, and the haul route map actually is a nice map in that it shows an area, a part of the Southwest that to this day has several hundred uranium mines, some of them that are 70 or 80 years old, that were developed at the behest of the federal government and the uranium industry, that have never been cleaned up and that continue to pollute land, air, and water that people and all other life depend upon. The Navajo Nation, in response to this abject failure long ago, banned uranium mining on the res. So too did the Hualapai tribe, and probably others that I'm not aware of at the moment. That was a logical response to the abject failure of the federal uranium industrial establishment in our region. Lands off the res are still open to mining, and that's an unfortunate fact of our life here in this region, and it adds insult to injury on the back of 70 or 80 years of legacy pollution that's still out there today. This region saw the largest domestic uranium spill at Church Rock in the 1970s. That spilled, I don't recall how many millions of gallons of tailings into the Rio Puerco, and therefore also the Little Colorado River. There are old upgrader sites around the banks of the Little Colorado River. Our landscape is dotted with old uranium mills. They're Superfund sites, but many of them are still leaking to some degree, and they're ultimately still considered temporary storage. That all also requires, at a minimum, that there not be any new uranium mining until we at least deal with the pollution of the past, and not even entertain that discussion until we've dealt with the pollution of the past mining. And that sort of principle has led our work at the center, which has involved a lot of litigation of uranium exploration and mining to various levels of success. We certainly blocked a lot. Some's gotten through. The mine, the Canyon mine, the Pinyon Plains mine, is closer than ever to development. We've been in litigation with the Sierra Club, Havasupai Tribe, and others almost constantly since 2007, up until last year, over that mine, but then other mines and uranium mining writ large in the region. So it's been a long and litigious and expensive battle that has stopped a lot. It slowed things down a lot, but it's not the whole picture also. And right now there is no active litigation on the Canyon mine. And what we see right now is that they may be moving forward with opening the mine. And this is important to note, every presidential administration and every governor in Arizona have been thus far consistent in allowing that mine to proceed, and if in court, defending the mine and its right to mine there on the banks of the Grand Canyon at Red Butte, in the Red Butte traditional cultural property of the Havasupai tribe. That's an important thing to remember. No matter the party, all the leaders have been on the side of this mine going forward.
No clapping. That's a little doom and gloom for clapping, but that's okay. You don't have to clap for me. I think. I am one of the co-founders of HALNO. We're a Hall volunteer organization. And for the purpose of this organization, I'll try to, or this part of the presentation, I'll keep it short. Our organization essentially has a two-pronged strategy that we developed in 2017 when Energy Fuels was essentially pushing an aggressive maneuver to open the mine. They were making pronouncements, we're going to open next year, a lot of threats, but it was unclear as to actually how practical those threats were. And so we mobilized. And the first prong of the strategy, as mentioned to some degree by Leona, is policy advocacy, looking at whatever kind of administrative or tribal issues that we can support, advocate for. We did our tour and we passed many resolutions along the route and garnered quite a bit of support and attention. The part that I'm concerned with is just stopping the mine. And I hope that's part of why y'all are here, is stopping the mine, stopping the transport, standing with the Havasupai, standing with all of those who have been impacted by the legacy of nuclear colonialism. When I grew up, part of it was at elementary school in Tucson. And I remember my mom yelling at my uncles, like, you can't come in here, you're wearing overalls, you're wearing white, there's white dust all over your clothes. In the 1980s, they helped to build the headframe and the initial supports for what was then known as the Canyon Mine and has been rebranded as the Pinyon Plain Mine. You know, if you look up the corridor, this area, as Taylor mentioned, you know, in the Navajo Nation, there's over 520 documented abandoned uranium mines. Just in the Black Falls to Cameron area up towards Tuba, there's about 119 abandoned uranium mines. If you talk to the EPA, not a single one of them has been cleaned up. There's never been a comprehensive health study, human health study, on the Navajo Nation regarding impacts of uranium. And they want to open new mines. You know, we welcomed, to some degree, the Obama designation and restrictions of new claims, because that would have been thousands. We know that. That would have been devastating for the region. We welcome the, and we'll talk about this, I think, a little bit later, the Biden administration solidification of that in the monument. But the fact that this mine is permitted, there's nothing stopping it except for our bodies right now. So I am here today to recruit. If anybody wants to mobilize, I will talk about this later in the questions. And we do have some resources we want to organize. And if we don't have enough time tonight to go over this, we do have a sign-up sheet. I urge you to connect to that. And we are looking at taking principled direct action to make sure that at least there's a message, even if we can't sustain the direct actions, that this community will not go down without a fight. And other communities along the route will not go down without a fight either, because we say all no.
Klee. So now we're just going to jump into our panel discussion. So I'm going to ask the first question and any of our panelists can answer. The new national monument designated by Biden doesn't stop all mining. Can you talk about what you all have tried and what options are left to stop Pinyon Plain uranium mine?
So I can jump in first. I think, I guess just to kind of set up, if Alicyn and Taylor want to talk more about the court case, there was a court case, and the Havasupai chose not to go to the Supreme Court. I don't think anyone can blame them right now in this atmosphere. Everything that Alicyn will present and Taylor, I think these are things that have been tried. For Hall No, for us specifically, we like Klee said, we have a two-pronged approach. So the policy side and then the action side. And so from Navajo Nation, as Diné people, Serena and I, we did present to some of our committees. We went to Navajo Nation elected officials since Russell Begay, and then, you know, we've been in communication with Jonathan Nez. I haven't spoken to this new president, but I did speak with the vice president. And so just to kind of move the conversation along, the things we've been told, there's different things depending who you're talking to. So if it's a local Navajo elected official, let's say a chapter president along the hall route, they're going to say, yeah, let's stop these trucks. Let's put our bodies out there. Let's do whatever we can. Let's send the Navajo police, even though they don't have jurisdiction. It's a fight of our sovereignty to uphold our sovereignty. We're not just making these laws, for not being respected by Energy Fuels, the state of Arizona, or the United States because of interstate commerce or whatever. So that's a hard one to get the tribe to actually fight on that level, to say Navajo, to say state of Arizona, United States, you cannot haul your radioactive materials through our lands. That's going to be a tough one because that's through the tribal government. So that's one area where the discussion has been had, where elected officials are saying we got to do that. Will they actually do that? I think that's up to Diné people to push our government to do that. Just along these lines of education, on the policy side, we do have a draft Navajo Nation resolution for Navajo chapters that needs to be updated to again oppose this. Even though we've been calling for this for years, it's always good to get new resolutions and to get new statements opposing the mine. So from Navajo, we did, like I said earlier, we did a tour, and basically what we did was Klee, if you go to our website, and I'll put in the chat a link to our organizing kit, we did design a whole action tour that has all of the background information, and it has like a DIY download your own kit to figure out how to educate your own communities. And that was one of the biggest things we were hoping is that communities will take this issue on themselves. So us as Hall Know, we're all volunteers. We're committed to this, but as volunteers, our capacity is limited. So when we went from chapter to chapter back in 2017, it did bring a lot of energy and awareness, but to maintain that, I think that was a huge success. And I think the challenge was maintaining it. So over the years, people probably think there's no more fight. But I think with this new national monument, it was a real slap in the face. It pretty much invisibilized the fight, because a lot of people, including when I spoke directly to our Navajo Nation vice president, and I informed her, this was earlier this year, I informed her to her face, this is happening. And she said she wasn't informed when the tribe officially supported this. And if you go to our Navajo Nation president's website, it's the press release for the national monument is so proud of stopping new uranium mining, but there's no information out there that was either, it wasn't given to our tribal government, they didn't understand, they didn't ask, whatever the case was, it is missing. So this whole national monument basically invisibilized Pinyon Plain and made the threat even worse. So Hall No, you know, we're trying to get back out there to just do the simple education and to do what we know that works, which is talking to you all, talking to our friends and our family, our community members, and then asking you all to help spread the word, put up art, put up signs, pass resolutions, share on social media. It was very successful last time. Now we need to renew, revigorate. We updated all the information, but what we need is to update our crew, get more people involved, and then see who's willing to do some actions along the route. I'm willing to go out there and do presentations. I'm in school in Albuquerque. I can do Zoom anywhere, but it takes time to drive. And our team, we are volunteers. I'm going to put our donation link in the chat. It really helps for us to have some support monetarily. So please give what you can, if you can. And I'm going to stop talking for now because I know Alicyn and Taylor probably have a lot to share as well. So yeah, thanks everyone. And thanks for the question. I'll be posting things in the chat.
Thank you, Leona. And I, your energy is so inspiring. And I can talk a lot about what hasn't worked. And so I commend Hall No and its strategy and its forward thinking. We have tried the administrative route of trying to get really restrictive permitting for this mine, of trying to get better environmental reviews for this mine. We have gone the litigious route, as Taylor has pointed out, and tried to sue over this mine. We've tried to bring up the environmental injustice, the cultural sacrifice going on. We have tried to bring up the science and the research that shows the risk and harm that's being done there. And you know, as well as bringing up the history, there is, you know, we've exhausted a lot of routes. And so we are still trying to talk creatively and trying to figure out what our next steps are from the conservation community. There, as far as the Hall route, there was one other avenue that we did try, which was to go through the city of Flagstaff. The problem with the Hall route not being legally, so the Navajo Nation, as has been mentioned, has this law against allowing uranium transport. The state highways are not under Navajo Nation jurisdiction. There is one tiny, tiny piece of the Hall route that is not a state or federal jurisdiction, and that is in Flagstaff. It is, if the Hall trucks come through Flagstaff, they will get off I-40 on the country club exit, and they will be on a small, tiny little piece of the city of Flagstaff for a minute before they get back on the state highway on Route 66 and head up 89. We tried to get the city of Flagstaff to make it illegal to transport uranium in the city of Flagstaff. They did pass a resolution that was several years ago, and we probably should try to renew that. But they did not want to go the legal route. And I honestly do wonder if that was because they didn't want to be shunting the problem just further north, where the tribe would still be dealing with it. That further north route is dirt roads, so it wouldn't be possible all year round. It would only be possible in fair weather. But still, I do kind of wonder if the city had that question in mind. If they made it illegal here, would it just shunt it somewhere else? But I think that is something that we maybe should discuss more, because that's legally the only option that I see right now.
Yeah. The monument, the national monument, made permanent a withdrawal that was enacted in 2012. And what a withdrawal means is that the land was withdrawn from availability for new mining claims. But in the withdrawal, in fact, was to last for 20 years, or about halfway through that when the monument was designated. And the withdrawal itself made a 20-year protection out of one that preceded it 3 years earlier, which was a segregation, which is like a shorter-term withdrawal that did the same thing. So since, I think, 2008 or 2009, we've seen these the million acres around the Grand Canyon blocked off to new uranium mining claims, and all three of those protections, the segregation, the withdrawal, and now the national monument, are subject to valid existing rights. And so what that means is that mining companies who had claims before the segregation, which continued into the withdrawal, which continued into now the permanent monument, who had claims preceding that and who had done exploratory drilling on those claims in order to show a valid quality and quantity of ore such that it could pass the federal test for a validity exam. I'm getting a little bit wonky here, but this matters for what I'm about to say. Only those claims and mining companies that had claims before these protections and that had done exploratory drilling on those claims before those protections and had demonstrated that there's a lot of uranium underground with that exploration drilling and physical samples, only those mining claims survive the withdrawal, the segregation withdrawal, and now the monument. And so that's the universe of places that can be mined now. And there were, I think, four old mines on the North Rim, north of the Grand Canyon, that were included in that. Three of them have been mined out. One's probably mined out, but they haven't gone into reclamation yet. And then the Pinyon Plain, or the Canyon Mine on the south side, and then a couple mining claims up farther north of those four mines. And this is all to the west of Kanab Creek, the easy one and two claims up there, I'm sorry. This all matters because as a legal matter, to close down a mine with valid existing rights, you have to deal with the fact that the miner has what effectively are property rights to that mine and the profits that it could create if it were mined out, and to take that away from them under U.S. property law subjects one to takings claims, and they can take you to court and say, well, my mine was worth $1 bazillion and you need to give me $1 bazillion for taking it. And so there are major legal problems with simply closing the mine. It's more complicated than that, but it's been done before. And in fact, it was just done near Yellowstone this fall. A mine was closed. It was done on the San Francisco Peaks 2 decades ago. Different situations than this in many ways, but it has been done. It has been done before. The National Monument, even though it was subject to valid existing rights, and that's pretty standard, meaning that these mines with valid rights are grandfathered in. Even though that's the case, and that is unfortunate, it's pretty standard fare what I think is important to note is that that monument, the withdrawal that came before it, and the segregation before that, all those things required and resulted from a huge amount of public and tribal advocacy and leaders responding to that. And I think that any mine closure strategy here is going to require that and maybe more in order to be successful. But I will also say that for all of the reasons that the segregation, the withdrawal, and the national monument were created, all those reasons come home in the most profound, poignant, and brutal way in the context of the Pinyon Plain mine. And the Pinyon Plain mine, stopping more Pinyon Plain mines, was one of the main reasons, the chief reason, for all of those protections to have gone in place, to have been put in place. I think that's very important to remember. Insofar as we have a monument for the purposes that it was created, so too should we have a closure strategy for this mine.
Try to keep it brief. We wouldn't be having this conversation if anything had stopped the mine at this point. Biden, environmental groups, fight of the tribes, very diligent, very powerful. This is a sacred sites battle within the traditional cultural property designation of Red Butte, which I grew up with my father, many of you know him, Jones Benally, Hotley, gathering sacred minerals up there, learning the traditional stories. We have connection to Havasupai, who unfortunately couldn't bring representation tonight. It's one of those most holy sites, which is the place of emergence. You know, all of these deep connections rooted with a mine that's just miles from the south rim of the Grand Canyon. If we can't shut that down, what does that say about us and our futures? And so the decisions that have been made politically, economically, to prop up the nuclear industry, what we call nuclear colonialism, are moving forward unless we stop them. And so I just wanted to say that, and I think we're going to move on to the next question.
Yeah, to our panelists. So I'm just going to combine the second and third questions really quickly, since we are limited on our time. So can you discuss the threats from transport of uranium ore through this region, including Flagstaff, and what kind of notification is Energy Fuels required to give before initiating mining and transport? And also, what are the current solutions, and do you have any specific calls to action?
I'm going to just back, chime in, and then I'm going to kind of repeat some stuff that's in the chat. Sarah brought up, Sarah Fields, thank you for bringing this up, because we're talking about this as a new mine, but I think it's already been said the mine was licensed in the 80s. And so the threat of transport, it's always been there. Right now, we're just at a pinnacle point where it could actually start. However, there is active transport of nuclear materials going to the mill all the time on I-40, on the railroads. There's active cleanup across Navajo Nation of abandoned uranium mines that's transporting waste sometimes between sites. So this specifically, what we're concerned about is not cleanup, but we're concerned about new radioactive ore, possibly shipments, 30 tons a day, 12 trucks a day, something like that. Only in trucks covered only with tarps. I can play a video while the rest of you are chatting, but yeah, we definitely don't want the transport and some of this stuff. Even though we've known about it for a long time, the issue is we also know about we also know about uranium mining. We know about contamination. We know about accidents. We know about particles and breathing in uranium dust, and we don't want that. So yes, that's why we're having this event, and that's why we say hall no. But I'm going to ask Alicyn and Taylor to just go over the notification part.
Yeah. Before I get to that, I want to say I spent the last 2 days trying to research, get more information about uranium hauling from this particular mine. And I looked at a lot of, I looked for traffic data. I looked for accident data. I know that there, I mean, I personally know of about four different people who have been in terrible accidents in this region in the last several months. So I tried to find where that information was online, and I looked at Arizona Department of Transportation, and I looked at all these other websites, and I was able to find information for Route 89, but not Route 89 going through the Navajo Nation. I was not able to find anything for 179, which goes entirely through the Navajo Nation. These are state routes. The state is tracking information. Why aren't they tracking the information that is on the reservation? Like, why isn't that, why is the health and safety of certain people seeming to be prioritized above others? Is like, that's how I interpret that. Is it's just really hard to look at this and see it. There is a definite risk of running these trucks up through here. Before 1986, which is when this record of decision for this mine was signed, there had been five ore spills from Colorado Plateau mines. One of them was on the Navajo Nation. And when authorities arrived, they found workers kicking sand on top of the ore. That was in an Arizona Daily Sun article. Another one dumped over two tons of ore. In 3 years between 2015 and 2016, there were three different hauling mishaps, I'll call them, on the way to the mill where there were liquids leaked from trucks that were leaked onto the roads. And so people were exposed to the radiation from that. There is still detectable radiation along haul routes from the earlier part of the last century. There are places in Canada where they've gone out along haul routes and they've tried to identify where spills happened decades after the fact, and were able to find these locations because they were still high in radiation. There is very, very little monitoring along haul routes to see what the dust contamination is. And so there is potential risk that we don't even know about because it's not being monitored. It's not being looked at. So I'm going to get back to that, but I do want to answer the question of what kind of notice are we going to have before hauling and extraction starts? And the question is, we're not really sure. We don't think that there has to be any notification. We're planning to meet with the Forest Service, and we're going to ask them this directly. That's going to happen next week. So I don't have an answer for that question. I don't know if we're actually going to get notified. We may need to just monitor the mine and figure it out ourselves.
Well, just to jump in again, on the eastern side of the res, some of the things that were a result of transportation from uranium hauling today, there's still contamination along the sides of the roads, and just the way the rain, you know, goes to the lowest points on the side of the roads. One of the things they noticed in Church Rock was the drainage is where a lot of that contamination was found on the sides of the roads. So when the rain, moves the contamination off the road, it's right there along the bus route or the bus stops where the kids are, you know, waiting for the buses. So that was one of the issues. And so the transportation as well, you mentioned, Alicyn, I know there was the Ute Mountain Ute folks who are fighting the mill. They also talked about an accident outside the mill where it happened in the middle of the night. So the company just paved over the road. So these things happen if people are not watching, And so a lot of the things we know, a lot of the stories I've heard from the old mining, like, oh, this railroad car fell over and we had to shovel it back in. But was there any testing or monitoring or documentation? So those are some of the things we might have to take on ourselves, is just to be vigilant, watching for accidents, watching places where people are herding sheep, where there's open range, if there's animals and cattle in certain places. So the notification, I know with people that were fighting high level radioactive waste, when we're talking about a different type of radioactive waste, I was told for that transport, the earliest they could give, now this is high level waste, I think was 4 days. But for this uranium stuff, unless the Navajo Nation requests it, but then again, if it goes to the tribe, who are they going to tell? But maybe Taylor, I don't know if you can help answer the question, or if there's other mechanisms we can use to request for notification.
I do want to mention, so uranium ore does not have to be blackrooted as radioactive, because the average level of uranium is considered, or the average radiation is low enough that it doesn't need to be placarded. So that doesn't mean there's not veins and there's not, you know, variability and particles that are really radioactive within that, but the average is low enough that they won't have to placard. So they are not subject to the same requirements from the U.S. Department of Transportation as for the high-level waste you're talking about. 10 years ago, the mining company did say that they would paint the sides of the trucks with radioactive materials, but I don't think that they're subject to the same regulations. And so I've been looking a lot into emergency response, and the emergency response plan is basically that the trucking companies that they're using are supposed to have a plan, and then they're supposed to call Energy Fuels if there's an accident that closes a road. And so it's really vague. And this is one other thing that I was going to mention, is that I've been speaking to some of our first responders in our region, and they are also not clear on whose area of response, who has jurisdiction, and who's going to be responsible. City of Flagstaff might be the ones to have to go 200 miles away, because they might be the only ones who have the equipment to deal with these kinds of hazardous materials. And the first responders, I can't speak for all of them, but at least some of them that I spoke to are very worried about this. They don't want to be dealing with uranium dust on the side of a road, and they don't know how, you know, if it, wind happens, rain happens, there's very little clarity on if they would have to evacuate communities or what would happen. And so one thing that people can do is to email the mayor and council in Flagstaff, email the Forest Service, ask them who is going to be responsible if there is an accident, and what is the response time going to be, and who is going to go and deal with it, and is there going to be notification of communities? Ask them these questions so that they actually put pressure and on one another and develop a plan, because I don't think our first responders should be the ones that should have to be subject to the consequences of this.
I used to be a first responder on the res, whose jurisdiction included the White Mesa Mill. And I can tell you that if there's an accident and there's a spill, it'll be a volunteer fire department that has to deal with it again, across most of the route. And that may be different here in Flagstaff, but certainly in Southeast Utah, it'll be the volunteer fire departments that have to deal with that. And that's people like you and me who live life, work jobs, and when the siren goes off, they go get their PPE, jump in a truck, and go deal with whatever caused the siren to be rung. I don't know if or how we're going to be notified, the public will be notified about the start of this mine. We're going to try to find that out from the Forest Service. I'm not convinced the Forest Service knows. The Forest Service's position with regard to the mine is actually extremely passive. That is both an administrative and legal matter. Their position is that once the EIS was signed, the record of decision was signed in 1986, there's no additional ongoing federal action. They're not doing anything. They're not actively regulating. The action was done when the decision was signed, and now the mining company is to follow its plan of operations and that's that until the mine closes, and then there will be reclamation requirements with both the feds and the state. Hopefully we'll have an answer to that. I'm going to ask the state also if they're requiring any notice when the operations begin. It could well be that we learn about operations beginning from one of us being out there and seeing it, because we go out there and look, or a press release from Energy Fuels growing about the fact that they've begun mining in order to better mine their investors, which they frequently do.
I think that's a dump truck too. I don't think it's a hauling truck. I'll make this short because we want to get to audience questions. We want interchange, and we have to be out of here by 7:30. Library says so. Just real quick, I think it was in 2016-17. There was a delegation of us. I was working with Clean Up the Mines. There's a handful of us environmental folks and some other people. We went up and we saw snowmaking machines spraying water like 30 feet up in the sky. We saw trucks that were hauling tanks filled with water. And we're like, what's going on? And it was apparently uranium-laced water that had flooded from the shaft from the perched aquifer that was pierced. No notification. Communities didn't know. Tribes didn't know. We just saw it. So we are mobilizing, and this gets to the call to action. We have two things that, at least from the prong of approach for direct action that I'm calling for, one of is monitoring. We're asking people, and we are already organizing, we were just up there recently, weekly monitoring, because at this point we are uncertain, clearly, as to what kind of notifications. And I don't want to be too alarmist, but I will state that in all of the years that I've been going and monitoring since, before 2000, I don't even know how long back, around 2017, say a little before, I've never seen them this close to operations. All indications, including the level of development, they are an active mine right now. They're just not extracting ore. So let's be clear about that. And let's be clear that our eyes matter right now. So if people want to sign up, we do have a sign up sheet. We're organizing a weekly schedule for folks to go up. We can orient you. We can give you directions. We want to make sure that we're not, ringing the wrong bell, crying wolf, so to speak. But we want to make sure we have that information. That's what's necessary so we can respond immediately. And when I say we respond, those of you who also want to take direct action and make sure that the communities around are aware. And I'm not just talking about Flagstaff. We are, anybody who's in the chat or anybody who's here who lives along the haul route, we invite you to join us, because we have, if you go to the organizer action kit, we have a plan to, stimulate autonomous actions along the route and clog their artery, essentially. If we have successive direct actions that shut them down, we can mobilize and basically immobilize them. But we would like to not just stop them when they're transporting. We don't want this to come out of the ground. So we want to keep it in the ground as well. And I can talk, more about that maybe in the questions, but we do have a sign-up sheet. And in terms of call to actions and solutions, if anybody knows what a lockbox is, this is the kind of stuff that we might have to resort to. Hopefully not, because we don't want people to get arrested and feed the carceral state. We know where that sort of leads. We want a smart, sort of calculated, strategic way of intervening to make sure that a message is sent is powerfully as we can that is in alignment with the sacred values of this space, but also in alignment in principle with each other in affinities or not. We are promoting diversity of tactics. We're inviting you to join us. Please check out the Action Organizing Kit. It has all the steps. If you have further questions, the sign-up sheet is there. We're just asking two questions. You want to support or do you want to get arrested? Not everybody has to get arrested. Not everybody should. And I encourage you to mobilize with us and we'll figure it out. So sign up on the sign-up sheet. Yeah.
Okay, I had panelists really quickly in my own call to action. Like I said, I come from the res. My town was listed on that map. We are the largest community on the res to the city. I come from a family of downwinders. I am taking care of a grandfather, my Che, who is suffering from long-term health effects of being exposed to the uranium mines that are surrounding us. So please, please don't look away. Please don't turn your heads on my people and please help keep us safe. So I wanted to get to the audience part. If there's any questions that you might have, just raise your hand. I'll bring the mic to you and our panelists can answer it. Looks like we have about 15 minutes left, so.
And we're taking questions from chat too, so I'll read them off if necessary.
Thank you, panelists. For like clarification, my community question as an educator, as in, you know, talking to the next generation, I want to know how does Paul know, and thank you first off for being here in solidarity with me. I wanted to know how Paul know is going to mobilize the next generation, elementary school students, middle school students, high school students. A lot of mobilizations tend to leave out our next generation. And I was just wanting to know how we can be intentional as a community, right? And bringing in, you know, the Indigenous youth, the BIPOC youth. Thank you guys again.
Do you want to tackle that, Leona, or do you want me to? And can you take off the hall route, please?
Okay.
Yeah, this is an intergenerational struggle. The Havasupai have been organizing prayer gatherings for decades to protect this site, and it's been intergenerational. You know, our transmission of cultural knowledge is always intergenerational. The fight is a challenge, though, in terms of asking people to risk arrest, asking them to escalate actions. So we want to be as responsible as we can, and we want to consider all avenues of engagement. When we did our tour in 2017, we had whole families, because that's how our communities roll. I grew up in these struggles, in these fights, and that's always something, you know, from the knowledge of our sacred medicine keepers and practitioners, the blessings that we come with those, our elders to consult and advise, and to the young people. This is a cycle that is not, unfortunately, stratified for the way rest of society is. And sometimes that sounds romantic, but this is how I was raised and how we encourage our principled actions. I highly recommend check out our agreements in the Action Toolkit in terms of how we're organized. And hopefully that responds to your question to some degree. But I just say, bring it. Let's see what works.
So as Sierra Club, we had a campaign for a few years, I think the center assisted with this as well, where we had schools sign on to petitions because we wanted people who had been born after 1986 to speak about how they had been omitted from the public process that approved this mine. And
the whole idea that there was no new significant information since 1986 was just bogus. And so we had a pretty big campaign. We had had a lot of teachers bring this into the classroom and get petition signatures. And you know, another, if you're a teacher, that might be something to talk about bringing back. It's a very polite.
In terms of direct action, if transport would actually come through Flagstaff, can you give us an idea of what we might be able to do?
Yeah, in organizing for direct actions, we have what's called security culture. So in terms of this campaign, though, we've been very, and security culture just means like need to know, and we don't want the authorities to figure things out because it might spoil our actions and compromise people's, you know, well-beings, and repression of the state, particularly is very severe post-Standing Rock and many other struggles. But we've been very bold. We're announcing this publicly. We've announced this since the beginning of our campaign that this is in part a direct action campaign, and we're going to shut them down. And we've made that commitment. What it looks like is up to us. It looks like is up to you. What's your comfort level? Would you like to just be support? Would you like to do legal observing, police liaisoning, you know, any kind of level of action? But when it comes down to stopping trucks, that's where we have tools. You know, we have our bodies, we have tools, and we can train. We did an orientation training in November, I think it, or no, October, here in occupied Kinflana, and we're more than happy to organize more. And we have actually a list of different types of actions that are in the toolkit that people can sort of like look through, because there are different levels of actions that can escalate. And it's up to us. We encourage people to form what are called affinity groups, which are groups of no more than 5 to 10 people, maybe a little bit more, 15, that autonomously organize, figure out what actions work for themselves. If it's just holding banners and, you know, maybe providing support for people who are actually willing to arrest you, if it's one person, or maybe it's just not even risking arrest, it's just doing something that fits your level of participation and risk, that's important. Our main thing, and if you read our agreements, we're very clear, we do not want to put other people at risk. And we want to scale things on a level that is appropriate to the threat. But there are those of us who have been preparing, and we are seeking more people to be proactive as well. And so just be aware of that. That's sort of what we're recruiting towards tonight. And, you know, if I speak with a sense of urgency, it's because of what I have seen. It's not what I've heard from the Forest Service, not what I heard from the mine. We always hear conflicting things. And it's better to be prepared, in my opinion, even though, you know, others might downplay my cause and my urgency. But it's better to be prepared than to be reactive and not have a plan. So if we have plans, talk to our friends, we look at different models for actions that have inspired us over the years. Right now, there are powerful actions happening in support of the Palestinian liberation struggle. There are powerful actions that have happened consistently that we can model from and see what works for our community. And the goal is, though, stop the trucks and stop the mine. So keep that in mind. We're monitoring up to a point. When that point happens where there's an alarm, we have to mobilize.
Good evening, everyone. So I'd like to introduce me first. Yat e che spera koga me she tori chi ni initially ta zone e bushes chi ki on e dish ki on e dish na. So I come from the community of Tuba City. I'm still in high school. I was just curious about if you guys were all able to like come together, even if it's just over Zoom, to like present to not only high schools, but middle schools and elementary schools, because I think this is something that the community needs to talk about more. especially because with people my generation, they're very unaware of the impacts of uranium mining on the reservation and the impacts that it has now. And that's coming from me, who's had I've had a four family members who've passed from uranium mining, and there's also been mentioned of us in books and talks, and we won the lawsuit against the company that was doing the uranium mining of the res. But you know, as all of you have mentioned, there has been no cleanup at all, and I've you know ran into uranium myself, and a place where I grew up still has a open well that we're all not allowed onto because of that. So yeah.
Can you repeat the question for the online chat, please? Thank you.
So would you guys be able to do presentations around the res specifically, just to get the community informed?
I'm just going to type that in because some folks didn't hear it. Thank you so much. Leona? Hey, Leona,
yeah. Can you get that? Oh, do you want me to answer that?
Yeah, you're doing presentations, remember?
Yeah, so I am in Albuquerque, which is a little difficult to do presentations, but I think the best way would be to get, if your high school group or whoever wants to be trained on giving a presentation, and maybe y'all can help to do the presentations to each other or to even help us. I can train you on some of like all the information tonight. It should be on our website. Some of the things about notification, they're probably not, and these new topics are not, but yes, long answer, short answer. Yes, I can do a presentation over Zoom if I could go in person. If it's over like the holiday break, if the weather's good, I can drive out there. But for now, I'm going to put some information in the chat. You can contact me directly or email us at stopcanyonmine@gmail.com. However you want to do it, I think I put the haul route up earlier because I think we really want to focus on the route. And so if y'all can help us maximize the voice of what we're trying to do, doing presentations is one thing. If high school students like yourselves want to help us with a TikTok or any kind of social media, I'm not going to do any TikToks, but I heard that's what the kids like these days. So I would love it if you can help us to spread the word that way. And I will be happy to train you and we can go over the information and work on that level. Even doing presentations helps with other policy stuff like getting resolutions passed, writing letters to elected officials. There's a bunch of national people here listening to this presentation. I'm sure there's other national things that can be done. We're not focusing too much on the national. We really want to focus on the hall route and Flagstaff. So I'll just be quiet and put the information in the chat. So schedule with me directly if you want presentations to your community or you want to be trained on that or to get together to kind of work on the media messaging outreach piece, because we'll be doing that, focusing on Navajo chapters first and then other communities along the hall route, all focusing on the hall route.
One of our founders, Colno Serrano Riggs, said that they can do presentations as well, if you don't mind repeating that.
So if you couldn't hear him, he said that one of their founders, what was their name?
Serena Riggs.
Serena Riggs is willing to also do presentations. So I can definitely see that going on. Thank you for your question, Sparrow. Right now the time is 7:28. So we have a couple minutes if we can ask maybe one more question and then we have to start wrapping up and putting our chairs away and everything.
There's some closing stuff.
Any closing statements? Because I know you think we can get to theirs.
We'll go till they kick us out. As long as you all help us put stuff away. As long as you help us put stuff away and clean up.
Hello, my name is Tyler. I'm a Flagstaff resident. I just want to remind people at the city council meetings, if you are a speaker and you're representing, I believe, 10 or more people or 15 or more people, they will give you a 15-minute allotment to present. And I think that could be an opportunity for one of the leaders to talk during that 10 or 15-minute allotment versus just a 3-minute allotment. So something to consider. Thank you.
So any final thoughts, any ideas, anything, calls to action, last minute you want to add, any other panelists?
I'm done talking about politicians. I don't know what they're going to give us, but that's why Leona's doing what they're doing. I'm just going to encourage you to sign up on the sheet, check out the action kit. After we tear down cleanup, anybody wants to talk more directly? We do have, most of our organizing is on Signal, it's secure. We do have protocols for security culture. If people do not feel comfortable talking that openly about direct action, but they know that we're coming, they don't know when, they don't know how, they probably know where. So, you know, if anybody's down with us, let's go. And if you haven't already signed up the sheet before you head out, that's why I'm here today, is just to recruit, find out who can help us mobilize, find out what creative ways we can do, because direct action is not sustainable. We open up a space for creative negotiations. We open up the space for maybe more pressure at different points politically or socially, where we can intervene to ensure that our communities are safe. And that's our goal with this whole campaign, because our communities have been unsafe. They still are unsafe. The threat of uranium mining and extraction processing, the whole nuclear fuel chain, no matter what some big green environmental company is going to tell you about nuclear being like an answer for a clean, green future. No, it's a deadly lie, because that whole cycle, it starts with bringing it out of the ground. And we are still living with that legacy, because our waters are poisoned, our air is poisoned, our bodies are poisoned, and the land is poisoned, and we say no more.
Everybody, thank you to our panelists. Thank you for coming. I just saw one of the library staff come in and check, so it looks like it's time to wrap up. If you have any other questions, any, if you want to continue this discussion, if you want to get any of the info, contact info, come up here and let's talk. So
we'll also donate.
Oh yeah,
if anybody wants to donate, yeah, go for it, Leona, go for it.
Oh, sorry. You have the last word, Klee. I just want to tell people, talk to Klee about direct action, sign up with Klee, talk to me about policy stuff. And I just want to ask everyone to give a big thank you to our moderator. Thank you so much, Kaylee. Good job.
If you want to donate again, Leona mentioned it on our site, you can donate here at the table as well. And we'll just tear down real quick. Yeah, thank you all so much for coming out tonight. And thank you for joining us online, everybody who did.